extend your mercy and grace to your children, and you give us the promise of heaven. Thank you, Lord, that you're with us here on earth. You are a mighty God.
Thank you. to introduce to you our speaker of the morning. And he is going to be extending a special invitation to the leadership and the members of Tigard Covenant Church for us to come and be with him in Africa. Okay? So he's going to give you more details about it. But more important than that, he is here from Nakuru Canyon to present the word of the Lord. Let's give a hearty amen to Pastor Tigard.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I'm glad and happy to be here once back again. And I thank God because of this opportunity for me to be able to be back home. And that is why I want you just to turn to me and just say hi to them, because I'm back home. And just greet your neighbor. For me, just tell them Musmuba, David says hi to you. I also want to take this opportunity to thank God because of giving us the opportunity to be here and alive. Thank you for the opportunity, Pastor David, for ministering. This is your altar. This is your responsibility. And it's such an humbling and honor to be here and to share the word of God. Thank you, David, and the whole team for worship. And that's wonderful. And also now, let me invite all of you to Kenya and to Africa. For those of you who think Africa is very far, it's just very near, where soon will be, if people are going to Mars, and we are going to Mars, so we need to be Africa, which is not even on Mars. And humanity are really doing a lot of challenging things. So there is an opportunity for all of us to be in Africa, and also next year, 2020, we want to invite the leadership of Tigard Covenant Church, because we are our sister church. And together, Pastor David Bredding and his team, the leadership, the members, to come to Nakuru, Kenya next year. We're looking at having you in May, because that's a good time for your big crusade. For us in Africa, we will have an opportunity to put instruments out, go out for outreach, help us to go and do fishing. And we look forward that when you come back with a new fire to do fishing in Africa, in America, in a different way. So we just want to welcome you and to tell each and every one of you, we will have a good time. Please don't worry about any other negative things you've heard about Africa. There is nothing like that. We are going to heaven, and heaven is not like America. Heaven is just heaven. It has Africans like us. It has other people from Asia, all over the world. And we are all designed for a good place. And so just want to encourage each and every one of you that will be your best time to come. Together, I want to say thank you and also to invite you again back to Africa. Yeah, we are coming back again in September. After you finish up your summer holiday, you come back with the women, men, and young people of purpose. And we'll be in Accra, Ghana next year. And we really thank God for that opportunity. And so please, we have the best opportunities for you to traverse the world and to travel in Africa in many, many ways. Amen?
Amen.
And so we really want to thank you very much and for your prayers. I also want to thank Mom Phillips for giving us the opportunity to be together with you and also inviting us to come over here. And we're back in Africa. We are in different countries. We are in over 14 nations with women, men, and young people of purpose. And also we really thank God that you have always been our backbone, that you've always been our strength, and you've always prayed for us. You stood with us over the years. I also want to say thank you very much for the great work that you've done back home in Africa, for doing the well. I think many of you do remember the Well Project. And the Well Project has really served our communities. And this year we had a time when it was so dry. We had a big drought back home. And the well really served the community in Rwanda, where we come from. We didn't change the medicine, because there was no water that was running from the county government. And so the people were really suffering. And instead of them suffering so much, we had to grow the well program. And it really supported the people, helped the people. When the people were saying thank you for the water, they were not saying thank you to me. They were saying thank you to you. Because you gave your money, you gave your life, you gave your blood. And that donation that you made has helped us to reach out to those people and help them have clean water. Even though it is not yet purified, but it is saved their soul. It is better to have an unpurified water than have none. It saved lives, and we really want to appreciate you. Would you just clap for yourselves for having done this? Amen. Secondly, I want to say thank you very much for supporting us for the mission work to reach the unreached people groups. And we are reaching communities in Sudan and other areas of Africa. We're reaching South Sudan. It is one of the newest countries in the world, and it has no infrastructure. The systems and everything is done. And that is why today I would request our to just show you a snippet preview of where we are reaching. We've been able to be in Sudan, and we have operated ministry churches. We've reached the communities, and these are the people that we are preaching to. So you can see that we are reaching out, and thank you for your prayers. You really prayed for us. You really supported us. You've given for the mission of South Sudan. We really want to come back here and say thank you very much. And that is why we also want to encourage you and extend an olive hand that will you please join us to go to the unreached people. These are the areas that where we go. These are the roads that we go through. And you can see the impossibility of these roads. There is no infrastructure like that. And that's the vehicle that I drive always when we're going that track, and we call it Air Force One, because it can open up all the doors so that we can be able to go into different areas. This is where we reach out to the people. There are no schools, there are no hospitals, there is not even a single shop, there is nothing. We are at point zero when we are going out there into the unreached places. And so this is the church. This is the church in the middle of nowhere. This church is under the tree. And these are the people. You can see the joy. And you don't need to have everything to be happy. You just need to have Christ to be happy. And this shows you the life that is in these people. Currently, we are praying and we are trusting God that God will help us to be able to raise up money, to buy iron sheets, to build up a sanctuary, a place that these people can have as a church. And it will be used also as a school, which they can train themselves on elementary education, on the new generation. The children can learn to read and write, that they don't end up like their parents have ended up. So this is where we want you to pray together with us. You've supported us, we've gone into these communities. And now also we want to be a liver mark into these communities, that you can transform these communities. They are not able to have a school. They don't have any school. There is no school in that area. Nobody goes to school. Those kids wake up, they just live in that place. But now we are trusting God that we'll be able to help this community to be able to get a place where they can be able to learn, read and write, because that will help them for the generations to come. We are looking at the coming generations of children who are in that place who cannot be able to afford anything. So we didn't want to thank you that as you pray for us, these are the areas where we are reaching. These are the people that we are reaching. You can see we are just right there. We are not giving you something that's in the workplace. And when we go there, we don't have a suit and a tie. We don't have any other thing. We dress like them. And we sit on the ground and we sit on the floor. And we enjoy the service. And there are no seats. So please, if you come together with us, don't expect that there is hamburgers, there is none. There is no bread. We will eat what is available, and we will survive by what God provides. Amen. And so this is an opportunity that is able to challenge us, and just to, what a joy for someone to be translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. That is the most important thing. And so this is where we are, and I want to say thank you very much for your prayers. And thank you for standing together with us. Every prayer you prayed for us did not go in vain. Every prayer you prayed for us when we are in the middle of nowhere, there we don't have telephone, there is no satellite, you cannot do anything. Even the Turaya satellite cannot reach there. There is nothing. It is beyond, we are at point zero. So there we depend on God. And we will see what God can do. We've been there several times. This is when we've been there very recently. And we have also a team of people who are still going back in there. And we also be going back when I get back home to Africa. We are not related. We are going back and we are going to be serving God. Amen. I want you just to know that this is the area that we are reaching. If you look up there, you will see these are four countries that are coming up together on this area that is called the Oromo Triangle. This is, we have Kenya, we have Ethiopia, we have South Sudan, and we have Uganda. These are the communities we are reaching. We have blocked up this part of the map, to show you exactly. Even if you're on your Google, you can Google and you can see these are communities that have not been reached by the gospel of Jesus Christ.
These are the communities that are so backward. There is no gospel, there is no Bible written in many of your languages, and that is why we really need God to intervene. And this is our prayer, that pray together with us as we reach out to these communities. May the Lord God bless you. Yeah. Amen. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen. So, this morning I want us just now to turn back to the scriptures. Those are the pictures we've been playing, but now let's get back to the Word of God, because I have an assignment this morning. And I have an assignment for the Word of God this morning. And first and foremost, also bring you greetings from my wife, Martha, and the two children. We only have two, Chelsea and Kenneth. Those are our kids. And also from our church back home in Nakuru, Kenya. We are situated in the slums of Rwanda, but we are not a slum. We are the mountain of God in the heart of Islam. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we really thank God that Chuck asked me today about the guys that we reach, because even where we minister, Alvin knows, he has been there. There is a corner behind the church, it's called Jobless Corner. So if you reach Jobless Corner, and you look like you have something, they will take it from you and help you to keep it well. But we thank God because of the gospel. Nobody can take it from you, so you're safe. And so we want to encourage you to come over and you'll be safe. But this morning I want us just to turn to the text of scripture in the book of Acts of the Apostles, the 20th chapter. If you can have a Bible, probably you have it on your mobile phone, or probably you have it an analog Bible like mine here. It is important for us to have a Bible. And I love the Bible, I love the Word of God. It is very, very important. And thank you, Pastor. I believe in the Bible.
Yeah.
I know these days there are so many preachers who are employed, who don't believe in the Bible, but they believe in the church which has employed them. Yeah, I'm not employed by the church. I've never been paid salary since I was born. The church has never paid me even a single cent. I support the ministry, whatever I get, I put in. And I live because of the grace of God. And I thank God that the day my pastor, my spiritual father, he is just, on Saturday we celebrated his 50 years in ministry. He never, the day I went to start the church in Rwanda, under the tree and under the Muslim, when I asked our place minister at the Muslim primary school, he never gave me a single cent. What he did, he took the Bible. And he asked me, son, what do you have? I said, I have a Bible. And I said, stand up. And he said, okay, all your life are inside here. And he said, go. And that's how I went. And I went without any salary. I've never received any salary. I've never complained. And I've never gone back to him to ask anything. But I know one thing, that there is a God in heaven who is saved. So me, I believe in this Bible. And I know you might be struggling by believing in it, but I don't struggle to believe it. I believe in it because it works. It has worked over the years. I've seen what God can do. It works. It is beyond rationality. It is beyond our minds. It's beyond our education. It's beyond everything that we can have. The Word of God is alive and it works. Amen. Acts of the Apostles, the 20th chapter and the 32nd verse from the King James Version. I know that one is a living translation that has been put up there, but I want to read from the King James Version, because we have different translations. Some of you have the Contemporary English Version, some of you have the American Revised Standard Version, some of you have the NIV, but I'm reading from the King James Version. And the Bible says, and now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for the reading of your word. And I ask you this morning that, Lord, you will speak in our hearts. That, Lord, your voice will be audible enough in our hearts. And God, that between us and you, you will have the preeminence this morning. Lord, I ask you that this day, help us feed from the table of grace and love and mercy. That, Lord, as your word gets into our spirits, it will light up the fire, and the Holy Ghost will glorify your name in our lives, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If the weatherman, how many of us have seen the weather information in the morning? If the weatherman says there will be a storm, everybody panics. And everybody becomes aware. And everybody starts shaking because the weatherman has said the storm is coming. For those of us who live here, and you know very well that the weatherman might be saying, because of the kind of coldness and in the mountains in Oregon, it has started snowing. So the weatherman is saying, probably you might be having a bad winter. Every one of us is preparing to have more food. Every one of us is preparing for grocery. I hear you call it grocery. But we don't know what grocery is in our place. Grocery means a whole shop. So it's not like you here when you call it grocery. Alvin made me understand that grocery means this food that you eat. So when the weatherman says that there is a possibility of a bad storm and a bad weather in Oregon, all of us are prepared. But the Bible says that Jesus is coming and we are not shaking. But when the weatherman says a storm is coming, everybody runs. Everybody's on the application. Everybody's sending out messages. Did you hear this? Everybody's on Twitter. We were on whatever social media you are. You're telling people, be careful. And every one of you sends up an SOS, which says, I am safe where I am. Today, this morning, as we delve into the pages of scripture, I want to ask ourselves a question. Are we safe because He is coming? Jesus is coming. Whether you believe it or not, Jesus is coming. I have a conviction, and it's from the Bible, that Jesus is coming. On this particular day, Apostle Paul had preached in Macedonia for many years. He had preached to many people in those areas. And now he's calling back the congregation, and he calls back the leadership of the church. And he speaks to them from verses number 28 about how he knows after he has gone that there will come vicious wolves that will come into the church and into the congregation. He tells them, be careful. But on verses number 32, the Bible gives us four key things that are very important in the life of a believer. He says, number one, that brethren, I now commend you to God. Paul takes the opportunity to commend the church and everybody into God's hands. And if you go back to the Greek word, commend is parakitemi. And in Luke chapter number 23 and verses number 46, when Jesus is hanging on the cross, he says, in your hands I commend my spirit. And so for us, for the Swahili Bible, this text of scripture reads that in the hands of God, brethren, I commend. So this text of scripture, the first part that I want to deal with on this text of scripture is the issue of commanding. Where are we? Paul, when he finished preaching, when he's finishing his ministry and he's winding up, and he says everywhere, the Holy Spirit is saying prison, prison. He was not able to commit these people in the hands of another person. But Paul takes the entire congregation and he tells them, brethren, I would rather put you in the hands of God. And he says, I commend him to God. He says that, brethren, I put you in the holy hands of the Almighty God. It is only in the hands of God where there is safety. Nobody can remove you from the hands of God. It is only in the hands of God where there is protection. The enemy cannot reach you because you are in the hands of God. And Paul says to the congregation, to the church, that I commend you into the hands of God. Jesus spoke about it. And when he was dying, he says, in your hands, Father, I commend my spirit. So when you look about the word commend, the word commend has got many meanings than it has for us. And it is important that we look at it in various diversified ways. Because if you look at the word commend, the Greek word has two words. It has another word that is called sustain, which means to stand together. And then by standing together, to establish, it means to prove, it means to exhibit as a righteous and love of God. So when Paul is saying to the church in Acts chapter number 20 and verse number 32, the first part of it, that brethren, I commend you to God, he's saying, I now stand together with you, that I put you at a place where you will be established, and I'm giving you to a place where you will be approved, to a place where you will be an exhibit, that you love God. He says to the church that I commend you to God. And this, when you say commend, it is very, very important to understand that the word says, I commend you to God. The scripture has got four parts here, but we'll deal with it. But the first part, which is commending to God. When we are commended to God, we are put in God's hands. And that means, number second thing is that we are to commend is to praise. Is to be at that place where we are praised. When we are giving a commendation about someone, we praise them. That there is an acceptability about that person. Paul looks at the church and he says, as I live, God, he praises these people and he puts them into the hands of God. And in Luke 16, verses number 8, and the Lord commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely. For the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. If you read Luke 16, the Bible speaks of Jesus commending, because it is a praise, he praises the unjust guy. And it is important for us to understand that the word commend, Paul begins by putting them where they belong. The number one thing that I want to say to us this morning, this which admonishes us, and he says, and now brother, I commend you to God. The first sustainability of our lives is not ourselves, is unto God. God is the foundation of our existence. And when we are incarnate, we are put in the hands of God, there is a surety of the foundation that we stand upon. The second thing that Paul speaks is about unto the word of his grace. Paul is saying, I commend you, number one, to God. So you are in the hands of God. My brothers and my sisters, I want to tell you, there is nothing that is happening in your life that God does not know. You are in his hands. You might do everything that is possible humanly, but one thing analyze everything. You are in the hands of God. You are in the hands. You might not smell like you look like a holy person, but you are in the hands of God. You might not look like your face looks so holy that it's holy of the angels, but you are in the hands of God. You might be struggling, we struggle with everything. We struggle with problems everywhere, but one thing stands, even in the midst of every struggle, you are in the hands of God. The scripture says that I commend you into the hands of God.
Yes.
Whether it looks good, you are in the hands of God. Amen?
Amen.
And secondly, he says now, unto the word of his grace. Paul, he's going to step by step. There are four things that I want to deal with this morning. The number one is the beginning where we begin. We all begin in the hands of God. We all begin with God. Whether you are your science teacher, you know, the problem that we are having in this world today is that we all go to school, and we have religious people, that we have what we call religion, and probably they teach you Christian religion, but we are not with people who are not born again, so they don't know what they are teaching us, and they impart into us the knowledge, but the person who has that knowledge does not have the Holy Ghost. That's the problem we have in our country. We have a Christian religion, it's being taught, but the teacher of the Christian religion is not born again. And we also have the same problem when you come to the pastoral, when you go to theological colleges. The professor does not believe in the things he says. He says them because he will be paid a check at the end of the month. So it is about the check, it is not about eternity. But this morning I want to tell you, Paul says to the people that now I commend you unto God, and secondly, to the word of his grace. Hallelujah.
And now we come to the second part of this text of scripture. It is the word of his grace. There has to be a conviction about this word. It is not the words that we know. It is about the word of God. And I want to challenge each and every one of us this morning that there is the word of God and there are the words of men. But this is supreme to the other words. We might have a problem believing it because we want to believe what we want. You can choose to believe what you can choose, but this word will not be altered. And the Bible says, I commend you. Paul was a great apostle. Paul was a great theologian. Paul was a great man who was educated. But one thing he knew with all his education, the one foundation he had was the word of God. The word of God. Hallelujah. The word of God. And if you look at the word of God, the New Testament uses the word logos. The Hebrew uses the word dabar. Dabar means to make a thing happen. And in John 17, 7, Jesus said, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is true. If you don't know this, you are in a lie. We're having a problem in this 21st generation. We have Christians who don't know their Bible, but they know their form, they know their friends, but they don't have an opportunity to know the Bible. We were just talking with the pastor this morning, and he was talking about the importance of the word of God. Jesus says to the disciples and to everybody as he prays, says, sanctify them, Father, through thy truth. And what is the truth? Thy word is true.
Amen.
There are so many lies going around. There are so many lies being perpetrated. The New Age movements and everything. You can try to be religious, but there is one thing that is true. The truth is, the word of God is true. And in John 15, verse number 3, Jesus said to the disciples that now you are clean through the word which I have spoken to you. You are not clean because you went to a bathroom. There are so many people who went to the bathroom, but their hearts are not clean. There are so many people who have a perfume on, but they are still dirty. Because the word of God is true and it is the cleansing. When you hear the word of God, it changes our lives, it changes our minds, it changes our perception, it changes our eternity, it brings us to the road to eternity. And Jesus said, now you are clean through the word which I have spoken. Paul says, I commend you to the word of his grace.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Amen.
The word
of
his grace. It is important for us to understand that the word of God is very, very key in our lives. And in the New Testament, they use the word logos, which is reason, which is a discourse, and which is a speech. And in many cases, we have these two things. We have the logos, the reason, and we have the rhema, the one that is spoken. The spoken one. And so it is important that Paul is saying to them that we are not just talking about the word. We are talking about that which has got a reason. It can bring you to a place of reason. But then at the same time, it is spoken that it has power to change your life. So it is the reason and it is spoken at the same time. And the word of God, it was called, it was a revelation of the patriarch to the prophet or the inspired pastor. If you're writing, you say, I want to add the word. Is the word of God is a revelation. Genesis chapter number 15 and verse number 1. The Bible says, after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abraham in a vision, saying, fear not, Abraham. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. The word of the Lord came. Genesis 15, 1. The word of the Lord came. Look at Abraham. He did not go to a school. He was never a professor. But he had one thing. The word of the Lord came. Hallelujah. He did not have everything that everybody had. He had one thing in Genesis 15, 1, the Bible says, and the word of the Lord came into Abraham in a vision. What is the vision you're having? What are you bringing up and verses 38. The Bible says, and Balaam said unto Balak, lo, I have come unto thee. Have I now any power at all to say anything? The word that God putteth in my mouth, that shall I speak. And that is why this morning I'm here to tell you the oracle of the word of God. That the Bible says, and Paul said to the disciples, that unto the word of his death, where are you commended, my brothers and sisters? You are put at a place where there is the word of the Lord, which is a revelation. The second thing under the word is, the word was spoken forth by the prophets. The very word that we read about was spoken forth by the prophets. And in Exodus chapter number 4 and verses number 30, the Bible says, and Aaron spake all the words which the Lord has spoken unto Moses, that which God has spoken, and did the signs in the sight of the people. And in 2 Kings 7:1, let me quote the scriptures, then I'll come back to wrap them up in that one. 2 Kings chapter number 7 and verses 1. The Bible says, then Elisha said, hear ye the word of the Lord.
Amen.
Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria. And the last scripture I want to quote under that, it says in Isaiah 1:10, the Bible says, hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom, give ear unto the law of our God, ye people of Gomorrah. It is important for each and every one of us to understand, what are you hearing? The Bible admonishes us to hear the word of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
It's the word of God. And then the word of God also is a promise. That is why Paul says to them, and I commend you to God and to the word of his grace. That word that you're commended unto is a promise. And this is what in Isaiah 66 and verses number 2. The Bible says, for all those things has my hand made, and all those things have been, says the Lord. But to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and trembles at my word. Let me repeat the last text of scripture. This is the man that God looks at. And you know very well, for those of you who are gender proponents, that the word man does not mean a man. It means all of us. It means both men and female. And in Genesis chapter number 5, the Bible says that he created he them, men and female, and called him Adam, which means our gender is defined. So I don't think you will have a problem with that. So let's get back to Isaiah 66 and verses number 2. But to this man, thus says the Lord, listen to what God is saying. The kind of a man who is in tight covenant type this morning, but the Lord is looking at. But to this man, I look. Even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and trembles at my word. I don't know what shakes you. I don't know what makes you tremble. Some of us tremble when there's no food. But the Bible says this is the man that God looks for. The one who will tremble at his word. When his word comes forth, that man trembles. That man God is looking at. And that is why Paul says to the disciples, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace. That word has to have grace in it. And the word of God is a promise, and it's also a ground of hope. The very word that Paul is giving unto the disciples, it is a promise. This is the promise that we have. things that are melting our souls. Many of us have weights that we are carrying, but this word of God is a promise and a ground. Amen.
Amen.
It is the word of God that is a promise unto us, and it is a ground of hope in our lives. And the Bible says in Psalms 130 in verses number 5, the scripture says, I wait for the Lord. My soul does wait, and in his word do I hope. I don't know where your hope is. Probably your hope is in your money. Probably your hope is in your things. Everything gets down. People get bankrupt. Properties can be gone. But the hope that we have in the word of God is a sure foundation.
Yes.
Nobody has ever been buried by everything. Only the old African kings were being buried with everything. And so it was a very dangerous thing in those olden days to be a queen. Because the day your husband dies, there's the day you're going to be killed. And you're not going to be killed on that day. They wait first, you mourn, you mourn, you mourn, you cry, you cry, you cry. And then the moment they want to bury you, they look for all things. They start with this. Six spoons, they look for scalps, they look for everything, and then the last one to be put on top and they cover. So you know that's very dangerous. Everything that we hold so dear, we will go down with the knife. Hallelujah. But the word of God, that is the sure hope of salvation. The fourth thing, the word of God is creative, upholding, and preserving. The word of God, that word of his grace, that very word, is creative, it upholds, and it preserves. I know you love your daughter, I know you love your medicine, but they don't preserve you. It is this word that preserves you. And you love everything that you have, but none of those things can be said. And with my little experience praying for people in hospitals, and praying for people at hospital beds, and some of them are dying, many a times it are praying with people, some of them have things, and at that is the moment they tell you, nothing is important. Nothing gets important. And then when you go in, every time they say, Pastor, can you read me that? They even don't want to explain. They are hungry. They just want you to read it. They want to eat more of it. They want to get, but you here, you have life, you have everything. You are busy with your own things. But let me tell you, their day will come when his hand gets hold of you. That is the time you want to hear more of it. But the preacher will be dim. There will be more. And the scripture says, in Psalms 33, in verses number 6, that by the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth. This word is creative. It is only by the word that created them. He said, let there be light, in Genesis 1:3. It is the word of God that created everything. You might be believing in the West here, you have all these things that you believe. Where you believe you probably came from a stone, and most of you say you came from apes, and I wonder, why have you not evolved into another ape?
Yep. We're not, you kidding me?
Since the day you evolved from an ape to a human being, why is it that you have not gone back to the process? Because the process always is B67. So I challenge all of you scientists over here, why have you not gone back to that same process? Why are you still humans?
Learn the hard way. Yeah.
And the scripture says in 147 of the Psalms that he sent out his word and melted them. He causes his wind to blow and the water. It is the word. It is creative. It is upholding and it preserves. Amen?
Amen.
And the very word. The word of God is personal. In John 1:1, in the beginning was the word. It has to be personal. It cannot be that there was a word. It has to be personal. When we talk about the word of God, of his grace, it has to be very, very personal. And in John 1:14, the Bible says, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory. The glory that it was from the beginning. And it is important for us as believers that we understand that Paul is saying to them that unto the word of his grace. Then he moves to the third component. He says, one, I have dealt in the hands of the source, which is God. At the source, there is the word. And what does the word signify? The bread of life. Are we together? Now let's move. I have put you at the beginning. I return you back into the hands of God. And when he returns them back to the hands of God, there in the hands of God, there is bread of life, which is the word of God. And when they eat this bread, it is able to build you up. Now, this is getting the let's now travel on this. Then the scripture says, I now commend you unto God. That's the first place. We begin with God. And where we are with God, the Lord God has a word which is full of grace. And that word that has grace, that word makes us now, it says, and this word which is full of grace is able to build you up. It is able to make you grow. Now, if we go to the next level, when we are in the church, when we are limited to on this church, when you are born again, you are put in the hands of God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And because you are put in the hands of God, you are brought into this place to be fed the word of God. Amen. You are at a place where the word is saving your life. And then when you are fed the word of God, he has to grow. Look at your neighbor. He has to grow. He has to grow. You know, it is unfortunate that it's only we are growing in our bodies and our hairs are turning gray, but our hearts are not growing. We are still having diapers in the spirit, and we want a good word to make us good men. I do not come to make you good. I'm on assignment, and my assignment is to tell you that God has commended you in his hands. In his hands, he has the word of life, and that word is able to grow you up.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That is why building in the Greek is okoinoma. And that is a house. We are building. If you are building, and most of you here are builders, you own homes. So you know what is the process of building. It is not easy. You know that every building has a foundation. And when you are building, that means the foundation has to go deeper. There has not a single day. Have you ever seen the foundation shining? If the foundation is seen, there is a trouble, there is a problem. What we see on top here is not what holds this building. What we see here is held by the foundation. The foundation is in the hands of God. The foundation is in the word of God. When you get to the foundation, you start building up.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We start building up. And when we start building up, things start happening in our lives. And David, and before I come to David, let me come to his grandmother, Ruth. Ruth comes into Israel together with Naomi.
And Orpa goes back home. And when she gets in, it is the mother-in-law who taught her how to get the next husband. But the mother-in-law, Naomi never taught Ruth how to get him her own son. In Moab, Naomi was not the teacher. She was the recipient. But now they are back in Bethlehem. Naomi is the professor. And she tells Ruth key steps.
So you come to the women of purpose. So you get those. Let's go back to this.
In Ruth chapter number 4 and verses 11. And as the marriage is going on and everything is happening, this is the blessing that the people say to Ruth and unto Boaz. And it says, and all the people that were in the gates and the elders said, we are witnesses. The Lord made the woman that is come into thy house like Rachel, like Leah, which too did build the house of Israel and that dwelling in Ephraim and be famous in Bethlehem. I picked this portion of scripture because when we are growing up, when you have to build up, we have to build up on the foundation. Ruth does not build up alone. Most of us here, we like walking alone. Most of us here, we are solo. We like being solo. We are like a buffalo. In Africa, we are buffaloes. Only the old Rome buffalo is the one that walks alone. But the rest of the herds walks with the others. And most of us are just solo. We love being solo. We are with nobody. We are a master of our own selves. We submit to nobody. But let me challenge you today. There is power in the unity. Amen. There is power in the unity.
Yes.
And some of us have been hurt. Yes, you are hurt, but that was meant only to help you grow. There is nothing that does not hurt. Even the good things hurt. You people are the ones who invented sugar. Are you not the ones these days running away from sugar? You ship it to us in Africa. Because you think we want it. You are why running away from sugar? It is so sweet, but you are not taking it. If today we were, even in this room, so many of you don't take sugar. And it was invented. We invented the sugar. It is so sweet. So that nothing does not hurt. Everything hurts. And on this text of scripture, it says that they blessed Ruth to build like Leah and Rachel. The two women, the Bible says, they build Israel, the house of Israel.
You see, now there's a difference. We know that men says they are the ones who build. Go back to the text of scripture, realize women, that's why the Bible says, they are the ones who make the home better. Because they build.
I need a tray for you.
So it is important for us to understand that Paul is now coming from this theological concept and he says to them that, brethren, once you are in the hands of God and you are in His Word, you are feeding on the Word, that which you eat every day is able to build you up. If there is something that will build the church, if there is something that will build our faith, it is the Word of God. We are busy talking about miracles and everything, but build yourself. Build your holy faith in the Word of God. If we build ourselves in the Word of God, we saw a lot of things that we look at. But we build ourselves in the Word of God. And Jesus gave this parable in Matthew chapter number 7, from verses number 24 to 27. He gave this parable on building up. Let me use this one. Jesus said, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. He says in verse number 25, and the rains descended, and floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon the rock. There are four things that will always come against humanity on earth. Number one, there is floods. There are floods. Things will flood your life.
Trouble will flood you. Floods will come, my brother, my sister. Floods, whether you are young, nothing is happening now, you think you are at the prime of your life, floods will still catch up with you. Probably you escaped the floods when you are young, now you are old, you think you know you are finished. When you are retired, floods come of many things. Many problems are flooding in your life. You even wonder which door opened. This will come in life. The second thing that comes into the life of a human being is the winds. The winds will blow. The winds will take away the things you hold most. The winds will pull down things that you built. The winds will do their destruction. And then it does what? It beats upon that house. There is a beating that goes on. Do you remember this house we are in? All of us, we are in this house. But we are not this house. All of us has a house here. Forget about these people that are here. We all have this house, and we are in this house, and we don't belong to this house. And in this house, there is a wind that is blowing. On this house, there are floods. On this house that we are in, there is the beating. And when all these things are happening, Jesus likened the person who hears his word. He is just growing, and that word builds him up. And it is important for us as a church to be able to understand that the building, when the Bible speaks about building us up, the scripture says in 1 Corinthians 3:9 that we are laborers together with God. You are God's husband, you are God's building. So if we are a building of God, then God is building us up. So we can be able to be built up into the things of God.
Amen.
And then Paul is saying that, beloved, this one is able to build you up. It doesn't build you, it doesn't tear you down. It builds you up. And we have to understand that believers are built up in Christ. We have to be built up in Christ. Ephesians chapter number 2, verses number 20. 22nd. And the Bible says, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. There is a building that has to continue. We have to be built up. And as a church, if there is something that, and the Bible says, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord. In whom we are built together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. So Paul says this is able to build you up. And as we are built up, Colossians 2:7, the scripture says that we being rooted and built up in him, established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. You know that there are things that until you are built up, thanksgiving will not come forth. And Jude 1:20, the scripture says, on building up, let me go finish with this one. It says, but ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
So there is a need for you to also build up yourself. When you leave the building, you don't just need to build yourself. The Bible says that, beloved brethren, building up on yourselves, on your most holy faith. You see, your faith is so holy, your faith is so important, that there is a need for you to build up and you pray in the Spirit of God. And so when we look about this text of scripture, Paul is telling us, he starts on a journey that I commend to God. Then at God's hands, he says, there is the next thing of that which has commended you to God, is unto the word of God. And then, which is able to build you up. And when it builds, what does it do? Let's go now to the result of it. The scripture says, and is able to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. This text of scripture is rich because it has got a promise. An inheritance is a promise. Paul is saying there is an inheritance for each and every one of us. There is a promise of eternal life. And this is a point where many of us are struggling with the inheritance of God. Because many times we have inherited things and they have gone. Most of the things that are put in our hearts, they are no longer there. And you know, in the West here, you have a better plan. For us in Africa, the inheritance of the family can never be sold. Here in the West, you sell them. And you move to another state. For us, you can sell. It's different. So when I talk about inheritance, where our father was buried can never be sold. Even if you have all the money, even if you are dying with money, you cannot sell that. It remains a family inheritance. But for you here, you sell them because you think it is not profitable. That is why we miss it. When you talk about inheritance, let me try to wrap up the inheritance quickly so that I finish up and let you go, and because you are not like us, we sit more in charge. So most of you are now persevering. So before you start persevering, so let me wrap it up. The scriptures talks of inheritance. In Acts, the 7th chapter and the 5th verse, and the Bible says, and he given him none inheritance in him. No, not so much so as to set his foot on. Yet he promised Abraham that he would give it to him for a possession and his seed after him, when as yet he had no child. This is the inheritance that we are talking about. Abraham is promised to have the whole land and to have a nation, and there is no Ishmael, there is no Isaac, but the promise is there.
Hallelujah.
And so the scripture says there is an inheritance. The Bible says Abraham was taken into the land. He walked into the land, but even as he walks in, he's told you will have children who will not then he has none. He reaches at a time when he had to pray to God and say, God, it is Eliezer of Damascus. Who is my servant? Who will take all of them? And God rebuked Abraham and said, no, Eliezer will not take your inheritance. It is someone from your loins. Let me tell each and every one of us here today that you are from the heart of God. You are born again. We are in the family of God. This family is not poor.
Yes.
This family has things.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Where there is the hand of God, there is a word that will be there with grace. That grace will take you through times when you feel like you have done. But the grace will take you. And when the grace takes over, it starts growing you. And you start growing up. You grow up in your most holy faith. You start growing towards the things of God. You know, there's all these things that are going on in the world. Where people say, well, I'm feeling. You don't need to feel. Grow.
Shouting, we are under attack, but they can't see. The only one who pulled that went
And we still had the joy to meet the believers and sing with them. That is what I want to tell you, my brothers. Some of you are so discouraged because of something that happened probably in the family. Some of you are so down today, this morning, because you woke up, you didn't eat some breakfast. Turn it into a fasting. Tell God it was an opportunity to fast, to see to your face. That is why we were here. And that is God will be blessed, and His name will be glorified. And things have to move on. And one thing that has to tell you, let me tell you, when we are looking for comfort, comfort will not come. Simply because it is convenient doesn't mean it is already all right. Sometimes it is not convenient, but it is what God has decided for us. And let me challenge all of us. There is an inheritance that God has made for those of us who are afraid of our future. You're not so sure of where you're headed. I want to challenge you today. There is an inheritance. The inheritance is eternal life. And eternal life, you have to be born again.
Yes.
You must be born again.
Yes.
Let me challenge all of us, if you are not born again, you are on your road to eternal damnation. It is telling us that in this generation and age, we are only told to be good and to be nice people, but we are not told to tell someone, however good we are becoming, we are living. Eternal damnation. I want to challenge each and every one of us here that it is important that we give our lives to Jesus Christ. Because when we give our lives to Jesus, we put them in the hands of God, and we will be fed the word of God, and then we will grow, and we will have an inheritance which is eternal life.
Yeah.
There is an inheritance for us. That is eternal life. That is what God calls us. Can we bow our heads for a moment? That is an inheritance that God has
given us.
And as we are sitting here,
it's not the right amount.
We have an inheritance that God has given us. And probably in our minds and in our hearts, we might be mixed up with so many stuff. We might have gone through so many things that we feel like some of these things are not real. And as I'm speaking to you, say, Pastor, you don't know me. You don't know what I've gone through. I know you've gone through a lot of things. But the things you've gone through cannot negate the word of God. They cannot remove the authenticity of the power of the word of God in your life. And as we bow our heads and our eyes are closed, as we think about our eternity, we think about our future, in whose hands are you? Some of us are in the hands of men, and they have done so many nasty things to us. When you are handed over in the hands of people, caretakers. Some of you are handed over in the hands of your parents, or in the hands of your relatives, they did wrong things to you. You don't trust the pastor. You don't trust anybody. You come to check out you have a problem of trust. Today I want to tell you, there is the hands of God. When you give your life to Jesus, He is able to change your destiny.
Yeah.
He is able to change your destiny. It's all about our destiny. It's all about our destiny. And we are here. And you have never given your life to Jesus. This is an opportunity that you can transform and change your destiny. I don't finish up in service without giving you an opportunity to give your life to Jesus. That is more important than anything else. It's more important than anything else. In our lives, you're here, you've never given your life to Jesus. You are a good person, God bless you. You give your money, God bless you. You support good causes, God bless you. But you have no personal encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're here, you're not giving your life to Jesus. Just lift up your hands and pray with you. Because God will transform your life. It is possible. You don't need to be ashamed. This is the time that God will just revamp our hearts and change our lives. And that is what I said. I don't live here. I don't stay with you. I don't know many of your things. I know one thing. The word of God is saying. He's able to change. Save the and it's all about your eternity.
Yeah.
It's all about your future. It's all about your eternity. If you're here, you're not giving your life to Jesus. Just raise up your hand and pray with you. Whatever. Or pray with you.
Okay. Well, I have
that is important. Very, very important for you. Because there is God speaking to our eternity. Our eternity is more important than what we are present. That's what God wants to change.
Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you because you are the God who has to warn your lives. And Lord, this morning, as we commend each and every one of us here, and this morning, Father, unto your word which has got rest and truth, that which is able to build us up and is able, O God, to give us an inheritance among them that are sanctified. And Father, we want to thank you. We want to bless you. We want to exalt you, O God. You are one of us. You are one of every Lord. As you strengthen our hearts and our souls, that Lord is serving you. Daddy, there are people here who are sick in their bodies. And our Father will raise up the faith of your word that is able to heal them, O God. And we send forth the power of your word from these altars in the name of Jesus.